flower is outwardly beautiful, but you know there's something to a flower that attracts you even more than its outward beauty, isn't there? We should all know what it is. Because when you get close, it hits you often before the sight. It's the fragrance. Ever wonder why God made them smell so good and look so beautiful? Because he wants you to come and look. He wants you to come and look. He wants us to look today. Have you ever done that? I'm going to share a little testimony with you. When I was a young man, in my mid-teens, I'd say 16, 17, my mother used to like to go and visit different museums. And one day she said, "Would you like to go visit a museum with me?" And I said, "Well, sure, Mom." She said, "What did you have in mind?" And she said, "Well, I thought we'd visit the art museum." And so I thought that sounded good. I liked art. And so we went and visited this art museum. And you know, it was a beautiful time. We got to see a lot of impressive artwork. And one thing struck me as I was walking through this museum. I would behold these pictures from a distance, and I would just stand there. Sometimes I'd just stand there for 5 or 10 minutes at a distance and look at it and be overcome with how beautiful it was. And after a while, I would approach closer and closer and closer. But as I approached closer, something even more impressive struck me. And that was what looked so beautiful at a distance didn't always look so good close up. I began to see that not everything was in perfect proportion. Some of them weren't exactly right. There were little flaws here and there that marred its perfection. And at the time, the significance of that really didn't dawn upon me. But after I became a Christian, I thought back to that experience, and I realized that with the things of man's creation, the closer we come to them, the more flaws we see. And if any of you get close to me, I'm sure you'll see the same thing. I have flaws, and I'm sure you'll see them. But you know, with the flowers, that which is to us to represent the beauty of Jesus, the closer we come, the more we will see how perfect he is. Because that's the way God's creation works. The closer you come to it, the more inspired, the more taken with awe you will be. You'll begin to see the perfection, the detail that went into such a little thing. And some of the most impressive flowers you'll find not in a gorgeous green garden. You find them in places like Arizona, Colorado, New Mexico, with little desert flowers. And you need one of those big magnifying glasses to see them. But as you stoop down and you look at these tiny little flowers, you can't even see them with the naked eye. They're so tiny. And people didn't discover them until recently, that they even existed. But they're there. And people would go out to the desert and they would take their magnifying glasses and look at these flowers, and they were overwhelmed at the stunning beauty and detail in something so small that it would take smaller than the needle point to decorate it. So tiny that the finest of needles couldn't adorn it. God took such care with something so small, something that no one would ever really see. What does that tell you and me about him? Where his attention is? What does he care about? Does he care about the big things? Yeah, he does. But he also cares about the little details. the minute details. And God made sure that the smallest detail was perfect. Perfect. And that leads me to a thought that I want to share with you, taken from the youth instructor. And before I share this quote with you, just a little side thought. You know, the two most prolific periodicals that we have as a people, the Review and Herald and the Signs of the Times, Sister Wright wrote more articles for them than she did for any other periodical. But aside from those two, because they were the great voice of our people to the world, of all the other periodicals for which she wrote none anymore. She wrote the most, I should say, for the youth instructor. Why?
Young people.
She had a love for young people, to educate them, to point them to Jesus, to prepare them for a work to do for the Lord. And I just wanted to share that little thought with you. Where should our focus be? Brother, parents? Are we preparing a next generation? Should there be another? Are we looking to prepare them to bear the burdens that the ministers and elders are bearing today? Are we ready, young people, to take up that load? In Youth Instructor, January 17, 1901, paragraphs 5 through 7, I believe a portion of this was shared last evening with us by Pastor Allen. But I want us to look at the context. I think he quoted the last paragraph in here. But we're going to look at the context of that quote. It begins, "As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he." Many thoughts make up the unwritten history of a single day. And these thoughts have much to do with the formation of character. We learned about how that works last night, didn't we? How that thoughts lead to actions. Actions lead or create habits. And habits form character. Our thoughts are to be strictly guarded. For one impure thought, how many?
One
impure thought makes a deep impression on the soul. An evil thought leaves an evil impress on the mind. If the thoughts are pure and holy, the man is better for having cherished them. By them, the spiritual pulse is quickened, and the power for doing good is increased. Did you ever want to increase your power for doing good? Let's take this counsel then. Let's learn to guard our thoughts, as Brother Michael was sharing with us this morning. And as one drop of rain prepares the way for another in the moistening of the earth, so one good thought prepares the way for another. In that phrase, I hear the voice of the Master. For Jesus loved to draw lessons from nature. That was his schoolroom. He would lead people out into the fresh air, the sunshine, the hill, by the sea, and he would teach them. And here she draws a lesson that anyone who's ever worked in the soil knows. That if you want to moisten it, you want to loosen the soil up, you just add a little water. And she says, as one drop prepares the way for the next drop so that it can sink deeper, and each drop prepares the way for the one to follow. So one good thought prepares the way for another. Or what does that say for evil thoughts, too? She continues, the longest journey is performed by taking one step at a time. A succession of steps brings us to the end of the road. The longest chain is composed of separate links. If one of these links is faulty, the chain is worthless. Thus it is with character. A well-balanced character is formed by single acts well performed. One defect cultivated, instead of being overcome, makes the man imperfect. and closes against him the gate of the holy city. He who enters heaven must have a character that is without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Not that defileth can ever enter there. In all the redeemed host, not one defect will be seen. God's work is perfect as a whole because it is perfect in every part, however minute. He fashions the tiny spear of grass with as much care as he would exercise in making a world. If we desire to be perfect, even as our Father in heaven is perfect, we must be faithful in doing little things. That which is worth doing at all is worth doing well. And my grandfather used to repeat that to me over and over again to help me to raise my standard higher in the work that I did. And it used to irritate me then. But now, I thank God for my grandfather. That he loved me enough to tell me, even when it hurt, that my work was not up to his standard. Speak the truth in regard to the smallest matters. Each day, do loving deeds and speak cheerful words. Scatter smiles along the pathway of life. I like to smile because you often get one in return. If you need a smile, just smile more and people will smile back. As you work in this way, God will place his approval on you and Christ will one day say to you, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Do you want to hear that?
Yes.
I do. Turn with me to 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 2. Did I say 2? Thank you. I meant verse 2. Thank you for the correction. 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 2. In this chapter, we should study every day. Because in this chapter, in the verses we're going to be reading, is the ladder of perfection. The steps by which we attain to Christ's character. Rung by rung, we reach from earth to heaven. And we're able to span that gulf. In chapter 1 and verse 2, we read this. The Apostle Peter writes, "Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord." And this is the theme of which the Apostle now enters, the knowledge of God. Verse 3, "According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue." Whereby? Who out here can tell me what whereby means for the sake of the young in this room? Whereby?
Hereafter.
Close.
How?
Through which?
How we achieve.
Through which? That's right. Whereby? It's making reference to something that has gone before. Whereby is saying that which was aforementioned is the means through which the following is possible. You follow? If I said, "Love Jesus, whereby you will be strengthened." Whereby refers to what? Love Jesus. Love Jesus, whereby you will be strengthened. You see? Loving Jesus is the means whereby we are strengthened. Whereby, says Peter. Whereby what? The knowledge of him that hath called you to glory and virtue. Through this knowledge, now Peter begins to explain, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And beside this, or adding to this, we might say, working on the plan of addition, which God will work on the plan of what, Brother Fred?
Multiplication.
Multiplication, that's right. Let's add beside these, giving all diligence, that's putting forth all effort, add to your faith, what?
Virtue.
Virtue. And this faith is the belief in the knowledge of Him. As we hear the knowledge, we believe it, and that is our faith. It's a simple faith at first. We receive Jesus as our Savior, as our substitute, and we recognize Him as our Lord and Savior. This must come, but we must add to this faith something, and that something is virtue. We must seek to portray that which we know. We must seek to portray the one that we love. This is what the Apostle Peter is saying. Add to your faith virtue. You know what virtue is, don't you? The word virtue comes from the Latin vir, man. And it signified the manly traits or qualities. And speaking to a man or a woman, it meant that which is noble, that which is upstanding and upright, good, that which is worthy of praise and honor. This is what we should be adding to our faith. She continues, or I should say he continues, sorry. And to virtue,
knowledge,
more knowledge. And to knowledge comes, or is to be added, temperance. When we learn not to eat such a thing, not to dress in such a manner, not to do this or to do that, we are to put that knowledge into practice. That we call temperance, right? Add to your knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For, what does for mean?
When you do.
For is pointing to something. He's drawing a conclusion. It's like saying therefore. It's a shortened form, we might say, of therefore. He's drawing his conclusion now. For, if these things be in you and abound. Notice he says they're not only to be in us, idle, like a stagnant pool, but they are to be what?
Abounding.
Like a spring. A spring abounds, doesn't it? Its waters issue forth. They flow forth. They're living. They're not dead or stagnant. But these things be in you and abound. They make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful. In what? In the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. If these things be in you and abound, will we be barren? Will we be fruitless? As in the parable of the sower, what kind of ground will we be?
Good
ground, won't we? Because we will be fruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Just what the Apostle Peter prayed for us. And this brings me to Colossians chapter 2, verse 3. You may turn there if you wish. I invite you to do so. Here the Apostle Paul tells us something about Jesus. But it's not only about Jesus. It includes the Father as well. If you read back up in verse 2, whom, it does not indicate number, by the way. Just to be specific, whom can refer to one or more. So it doesn't necessarily have to specify the last one mentioned. And I think in this case it's referring to both. In whom? In whom, the Father and Christ, are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Where should we be going to find wisdom and knowledge? Well, if you want to find treasure, you go where it is what?
Found.
Or treasure is usually hidden, isn't it? And this is, it says here, in whom is, or in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. They're hidden in him. They're not readily seen. And we'll see why this is.
I have the Bible on there. There's hidden treasures in the Bible.
That's right. And God allows just enough to penetrate the surface to spark our investigation.
Amen.
To get us to dig a little bit. And then we see, oh, this is a vein, a gold mine. And we begin to dig further. But notice Ephesians chapter 4 while you're there in these epistles of the Apostle Paul. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13. In seeking this wisdom, this knowledge, the Apostle tells us in verse 13 of Ephesians 4 this, that the purpose of God's calling, the purpose of our work, the purpose of the church, the working of the Spirit within the church is this, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of what?
Knowledge.
Not only of unity of faith, but in the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. As we contemplate the callings, whether it be to apostleship or to be a prophet, whether to be a teacher, a pastor, whatever it may be, evangelist, all these are to work in the church. They are God's gift to the church to bring about this very thing, unity of faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, not unto an imperfect man, but unto a perfect man. And it speaks of it in the singular, unto a perfect man. That man is one body. That body represents Christ's body, of which we are all members in particular. And we are to be perfect in that one body. Can we be perfect if we are not joined to the head by the muscles, the tendons, by the skin that holds us all together? Of course not. Notice what we find in the Review and Herald, August 13, 1901. As we search for these gifts in our own lives, notice what we are counseled to do. In our search for the gifts of heaven, we are directed to do one thing, and this includes all others. We are to believe on him whom God has sent as his commissioner to reconcile man to God. The attributes of God, of Christ, are to be studied and earnestly sought for, that we may be complete in him, revealing his beauty of character, as through Christ man returns to his loyalty and draws nigh to God, rest and peace and security come to him. To believe in Christ, we must come to Christ and follow him. Repentance toward God means the confession and forsaking of all sin. It means laying hold of Christ as a personal Savior and continuing to hold fast to him as the chief good. He is our Prince, our Savior. Only through him can we approach the Father. Loving him day by day and hour by hour, eating his flesh and drinking his blood, taking him as the man of our counsel, living by every word that proceedeth out of his mouth, only thus can we reach heaven. Only thus. Thus referring to what?
This way.
Everything that's gone before. Only by following this counsel. And here she's quoting she's, in a sense, well, really, she's quoting the Word of God. If you read that quote carefully, she's laying line upon line and precept upon precept, helping us to understand how we can reach heaven. I hope you're familiar with this quote, because it's found on the front page of this program. And I invite every one of you to prayerfully read this chapter from which this quote is taken, and I want to share with you. Because this is just an excerpt. You'll find it on the front of your program. And I invite you to go back and read that chapter. It's the story of Peter. It's the end of his life. And it's in the chapter Steadfast Unto the End. What God wants every one of us to be. And there on page 531 of the Acts of the Apostles, paragraph 2, she says this: none need failing of attaining in his sphere to perfection of Christian character. Isn't that a comforting thought? None need fail of attaining. By the sacrifice of Christ, provision has been made for the believer to receive all things that pertain to life and godliness. God calls upon us to reach the standard of perfection and places before us the example of Christ's character. He's given us the standard. In his humanity, perfected by a life of constant resistance of evil. Pay close attention to this. How this character was developed. I'll read it again. In his humanity, the same humanity that you and I have, perfected by a life of constant resistance of evil, the Savior showed that through cooperation with divinity, human beings may, in this life, attain to perfection of character. And she explains what that constant resistance is. She says, and links it in a Hebraic way with cooperation. Notice, by a life of constant resistance of evil, then she says the Savior showed that through what? Cooperation. Drawing a parallel between the two ideas. Human beings may in this life attain to perfection of character. This is God's assurance to us that we too may obtain complete victory. God has given us the promise, and that promise is the hope of glory. It's Christ in you. God wants us to understand what this means. In Colossians 1, verses 26 to 28, I know this is familiar. Let us read it. Colossians chapter 1, verses 26 to 28. I'd like to give more context, but we'll have to wait. The apostle says, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. That is what it means to be in, to have him in us, to be perfect. The apostle speaking here of those he was sharing in his letter. He wants to present them perfect to Christ Jesus as his gift and offering to him. And I believe many of us will stand among those that Paul will offer in that day because of this, because of his writings. Likewise, Peter and others. The apostles will have a rich harvest and will have many jewels in their crown. I hope to be one of those. View and Herald, January 1st, 1884. To be Christ's is to be consecrated to his work, to employ every power of the mind and every member of the body to do his will and to advance his glory. It is to open the heart to his word, to reveal the testimonials of his love. It is to have Christ formed within, the hope of glory, to contemplate his matchless charms until the overflowing tribute of the soul shall be, hear what the Lord hath done for me. Is that the overflowing tribute of your soul? This, because it's Christ in us, the hope of glory, I think this helps us to understand the language of Jeremiah in these verses. It's Jeremiah 23:6 and 33:16. They say the same thing. It's a famous passage that I'm sure most of us, if not all of us, are familiar with. It tells us that Jesus, the Lord, is what?
Our righteousness.
That's right. He is the Lord, our righteousness. Our righteousness is Christ in us, the hope of glory. For as love for him wells up in the soul, the result will be righteousness. But Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. It will be the outflowing of that love. And it won't be able to be stopped. And one of the prime examples to help us understand this, as was shared with us by Granny Ann, was the sanctuary. It was given to help us understand that God wanted to dwell among them, and more than just among them, he wanted to dwell in them. He wanted to be intimate with them. Just as we read in the Song of Solomon, he wanted to have that relationship that was only to be between those two. And in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul speaks of the system of types and offerings that were a part of this service of the tabernacle and later of the temple. He calls them in Colossians 2:17 a shadow of things to come. And in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5, those things to come were shadows of heavenly things. And they were not only things to come, and not only heavenly things, but in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 1, we're told that they are shadow of good things to come. Just as that shadow points backward from that cross, that shadow, if followed, will bring you to the real thing. It will lead you to that which is good, the heavenly. Amen. And that is none other than the Lord, our righteousness. And that was what the sanctuary is to teach us. It was to bring those Hebrews to Jesus. And just as you can't hide the joy in your heart, it's for this that the Psalm 50, verse 2 is written. Sorry about that. Psalm 50, verse 2. It says, out of Zion. Anyone know where Zion was?
Jerusalem.
That's right. It's Jerusalem, but a specific location in Jerusalem. Zion referred to the mountain upon which the temple was built.
Amen.
And that temple, it says, out of Zion, or that temple specifically, the perfection of beauty, God hath shined. That temple was to be a reflection of the beauty of Jesus. That's why the builders were given a spirit of skill to work it. No mere human talent would suffice. God gave those men, just as he did in the wilderness with the tabernacle, special skill to work, to build that, to be a reflection of the beauty of Jesus, to draw all the earth to him. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty hath shined. God hath shined. And in Psalm 77:13, which we heard earlier, we know that it is in the sanctuary that God's way is to be found. But very few do we quote the last portion of that verse.
Who is so great a
God as is our God? Because his way shows how great he is. Who is so great a God as our God, revealed in the services of the tabernacle? And when we look at what those services pointed, cannot you say by looking at Jesus, how great is our God? Because that's what all those things pointed to. That's the way. He is the way. You can't hide the sun. Now, no matter what garment you put over the sun in the sky, you won't be able to hide it, will you? The clouds can't. It still shines, doesn't it? Its light penetrates those clouds. You can't hide the sun. And so it was that the glory and goodness of God could not be hid, even in the humanity of Jesus. Even in his sinful flesh, it couldn't be hidden. And in Isaiah 53, verse 2, it's a beautiful verse. It's the second portion of that verse. And we're getting ready to wrap up here. Isaiah 53, sorry, I lost my page there. 53 and verse 2. Isaiah tells us, and I'm focusing here on the second portion of that verse, beginning with he. He hath no form, nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Speaking of Jesus. When he came to this earth, he didn't come with outward glory. But he came to show us what was really attractive to God. And that glory, that goodness, that love, that beneficence could not be hidden, though cloaked with the garb of humanity. It shone through and it drew disciples to him. And that's why Paul says that he counted it not robbery to be equal with God. He put aside that form when he came to this earth, as we read in Philippians 2, verses 6 and 7. Who was in the form of God? He thought it not robbery to be equal with God, not a thing to be snatched at, a grasped for greedily. But it was something that was a part of him, who and what he was. And that is why we find this event. In the Stick of the Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 2, Jesus was in the temple near the end of his life. The scribes, Pharisees, the leaders of Jerusalem sent officers to take Jesus in the temple as he was preaching. And these were no ordinary soldiers. They were hardened veterans, chosen for this task, because these leaders of Jerusalem did not want these men to be impressed with the words of Jesus. They wanted him to go and take him and bring him back so they could put him to death. But it tells us that the day was over. And the Pharisees and rulers waited impatiently for a report from the officers whom they had sent, set upon the track of Jesus in order to arrest him. But their emissaries returned without him. Why? They are angrily asked, "Why have ye not brought him?" The officers with solemn countenances answer, "Never man spake like this man." You see, that glory couldn't be hid. Dealing with violence and crime had naturally hardened the hearts of these men, but they were not so unfeeling as the priests and elders, who had resolutely shut out the light and given themselves up to envy and malice. The officers had heard the words of Jesus in the temple. They had felt the wondrous influence of his presence, and their hearts had been strangely softened and drawn toward him, whom they were commanded to arrest as a criminal. They were unequal to the task set them by the priests and rulers. They could not summon courage to lay hands upon this pure being who stood with the light of heaven upon his countenance, preaching a free salvation. These hardened criminals can bring themselves to do it. But yet, his people could. Let's skip ahead a little bit. But are we settling for less? In Revelation 3, we read about a church who settled for less, who put the standard lower, and because of that, they thought they were rich and increased with goods and in need of nothing. They thought they were good enough. And that was what led to the Laodicean church. And that church represents the people of the last days. That downward spiral again took place, for the church soon left its love in the Advent message. And this is spoken of in the parable of Christ when he tells, you can write that verse down. It's in Matthew 12, verses 41 to 45, and it tells the parable of a wicked spirit that is cast out of a man. And it says, that man, he sweeps out his house, makes it clean, and it says that evil spirit, after it wandered around, finding nowhere to go, it comes back, and it finds this house swept and clean and garnished. That word garnished means outward. It was garnished.
Decorated,
yes. And so he's, oh, great, perfect. So he goes and he takes seven other wicked spirits, more wicked than himself, and brings them back. And Jesus says, so the last state of that man was worse than the first. You see, he didn't improve upon it. When the demon was cast out, he didn't fill that worldliness with Jesus. And so the demon came back and filled it for him. Filled him with seven spirits more wicked than himself. And so Jesus says, will it be to this generation? Those that are of this seed, this Laodicean spirit. Many attend religious services and are refreshed and comforted by the word of God, but through neglect of mediation, watchfulness, and prayer, they lose the blessing and find themselves more destitute than before they received it. Why? Often they feel that God has dealt hardly with them. They do not see that the fault is their own. By separating themselves from Jesus, they have shut away the light of his presence. It would be well for us to spend a thoughtful hour each day in contemplation of the life of Christ. We should take it point by point and let the imagination grasp each scene, especially the closing ones. As we thus dwell upon his great sacrifice for us, our confidence in him will be more constant, our love will be quickened, and we shall be more deeply imbued with his spirit. If we would be saved at last, we must learn the lesson of penitence and humiliation at the foot of the cross. As we associate together, we may be a blessing to one another. If we are Christ's, our sweetest thoughts will be of him. We shall love to talk of him, and as we speak to one another of his love, our hearts will be softened by divine influences. Beholding the beauty of his character, we shall be changed into the same image from glory to glory. Now this seems to be my closing text. Hebrews 12:2. This is what I want to do. I'm sure you're familiar with it. Many of you could probably quote it. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Hebrews, says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, the one who began it, the one who authored it. But more than this, he's not only the beginner, the author, the one who originated it, but he is the finisher of our faith. And that's why the Apostle Paul writes in Philippians 1, verse 6, that he who hath called you He that hath begun this good work in you will perform it even unto the day of Jesus Christ. He will finish that good work. He is this author in you, and he is the finisher of it in you. Therefore, I pray ye, look unto Jesus. Let us look unto Jesus from now on and forever, and let us not look back.